be here. So I'd like to do networking between the instruct Eric Seitz, and Finland has just joined the instruct Eric, and so you're all very welcome. You know, if you don't get enough microscopy time here, you can come to Helsinki instead. All right. So I'm going to presume that everybody in the room knows about cryo-electron microscopy. Is there anybody who doesn't? Good. So we can skip those slides. Excellent. So what I'm going to talk to you today about is a series of studies which are somehow, in my head at least, linked together to which have sort of led us down gradually a pathway towards looking at antivirals. But it all starts with a sort of basic interest in how viruses enter cells, how they assemble, how they get out of cells, and how they infect people in general. Or archaea, or plants, or bacteria, or whatever it is that I'm working on at the time. Right. Okay. So today we're going to focus just on coronaviruses. These are small RNA-containing viruses. They include things like rhinoviruses and enteroviruses. Rhinoviruses are the ones that cause the common cold, but also they contribute towards asthma. And then enteroviruses are also responsible for many infections, and some of the things that they cause include meningitis, encephalitis, polio. And currently, there are no real antivirals that can be used for the treatment or the prevention of these entero and rhinovirus infections. So over here, we have a generic picornavirus life cycle from this review by Bagan et al. In 2018. And in red, I'm going to point out the three areas that we're going to address today. So we start off with a naked protein capsid, which is going to somehow interact with receptors on the cell surface. It goes into the endosome, where by magic, the genome will come out into the cytoplasm, where it will then start replicating. This is a single-stranded positive sense RNA, so it can work as an mRNA. Although it'll go into genome replication within these replication organelles, it'll also be translated into a polyprotein, and this polyprotein will be processed into small capsid proteins, usually 3 or 4. These will assemble, and from the assembled proteins, they'll interact with the RNA to make a mature virion, which will then escape either through lytic release or non-lytic release. So we're going to start with a story about RNA-centric assembly. And the reason we start with this is because some of these data were collected in Neeson quite a few years ago. So what is this? It doesn't really look like a virus. This is an asymmetric reconstruction of the RNA from within human parechovirus. And what you can see is that there are approximately 60 copies of this quite well-ordered RNA motif inside the capsid, and in pink is just a stem loop structure that's been roughly fitted into each of these occasions. So we started looking at these viruses some years ago, and I was really, really surprised to see this much organized RNA inside them. So over 20% is a huge amount of organized RNA. There was an X-ray structure came out from Plevka's lab in 2015, where they could also see this very well-ordered RNA, and they tried to read off the sequence of the RNA that was interacting with the capsid and managed to come up with a sequence of around 3 or 4 nucleotides, which they could see within the atomic structure. Now, the atomic structure, just like many of the cryo-EM structures, are icosahedrally averaged, and so the fact that you can almost read off the sequence means that there should be a recurrence of this sequence within the genome. So we have looked at several different genotypes of this virus, and we can see that, indeed, this really well-organized RNA is not a one-off. We see it in several different genotypes. And also in the cryo-EM reconstructions, this is now at around 2.8 angstroms resolution. You can actually very well see the base stacking. You can actually, again, read off the sequence from the reconstruction. What you can also see is that there are key interactions with certain amino acid side chains. And what Shabby did was to take a virus which we could manipulate genetically, and he did a few mutations in the genome. Firstly, he mutated one by one 8 conserved amino acids so that he changed them to being alanine. And in 7 out of 8 of these viruses, this resulted in completely dead virus. And the place where it stopped was at the position of assembling the viral capsid. So everything else was normal apart from actually making those capsids. In addition, he also took these RNA motifs that we have been able to identify within the genome by using CELEX. So this is a method of taking a protein and basically searching through a very, very large RNA library to see which RNAs will bind to the protein. We did this and found that there was an RNA motif that we could identify across the genome in many, many different places, which goes along with the structural work. And what we can do is to predict what sort of stem loop structure you're going to get from this RNA motif and try to melt it or make it larger than it would normally be within the genome. But to do this without actually affecting the coding sequence of the virus, all right? And if you do that, we tried it in a few different places in the genome, and in one or two of these places, again, we could completely kill the assembly of the virus, just like with the amino acid motifs. So this basically tells you that it's both the RNA and the protein interaction which are important for the capsid assembly in this virus. So the work hasn't stopped there. This was work that we did with Peter Stockley and Radon Twarak. So Peter's in Leeds and Radon's in York universities. And they've also looked at hepatitis B virus and also alpha viruses. And the take-home message from this part of the work is that in coronaviruses and these others, throughout the genome, you have these small packaging signals which are responsible for helping the assembly of the virus. And so basically, these packaging signals will be important for recognizing the viral proteins and nucleating assembly around the genome. And if you take, for instance, a drug which will chelate in these particular regions in the RNA genome, then actually you can affect assembly in a model system, and in fact you can inhibit assembly. And therefore this was one of the first instances we had of a new potential antiviral target, because we have a very, very conserved region of RNA and a conserved pocket of protein, which is really rare in these viruses. Normally they're mutating all over the place, but this is a site inside the capsid which isn't exposed to antibodies, and therefore it's conserved. And so Peter's proven that you can actually attack the RNA, but I think ideally one would like to try and hit and inhibit the protein pocket, because that would be a more unique solution than trying to cure everybody's viral RNA. Anyway, so this is the story of moving into therapeutic targets with these viruses which have multiple packaging signals. And I have to say that this was a bit of a controversial study in the field, because the big guys in picornaviruses have said for years that the capsids assemble and then by magic the RNA goes in. And we have, I think, disproved that theory. Right, so My trouble was that having done this study and thought, oh great, this is a fantastic new antiviral target, I was then starting to think, well actually, is it really? At least in the coronaviruses, because the pocket we're talking about actually needs 15 proteins to come together in order to form it. And also, three of the key residues for base stacking are on the N-terminus of one of the proteins, which is stuck between two adjacent RNA motifs. And I always like to think sort of mechanistically how assembly can occur. And I was thinking, well, if we say that the protein forms this pocket and then that nucleates onto the RNA and the RNA then starts to collapse into a particular structure and then the proteins form around the RNA, what are the first steps? Because you've got to get those 15 proteins together. And so I thought, well, maybe our theory is not that good, at least for these capsids where you have many different proteins. For a single protein capsid like you have in hepatitis B, I think the theory works quite well. Anyway, so I wanted to remind you that, you know, structures, they're beautiful, and they may represent a limited set of states, which will probably be dominated by those which are most ordered. Those are usually the ones that we like to look at as structural biologists. But actually, when we look at this human parechovirus, there's a lot of disorder in the amino termini of the proteins. You don't actually resolve all of the proteins in the structures that we've done. Majority of the RNA, 80% of it is, you know, disordered within the capsid. There's also a terminal protein that we don't see. So there's quite a lot of it that we actually are kind of ignoring in our analysis. So we know that intrinsically disordered proteins can undergo a lot of fleeting interactions with different partners and different affinities. And we know that these sorts of trans interactions are very important in cells. Think about how, for instance, the nuclear pore works. A lot to do with intrinsically disordered proteins tasting what's on the outside of the nuclear pore in order to transport things in. So I was wondering whether they might be important here as well. And so what we did was a series of studies using reversible cross-linking, RNA affinity purification, and peptide mass fingerprinting, which is otherwise known as RCAP analysis. And basically, we looked to see which parts of the proteins in whole variants, in individual proteins, and also just with intrinsically disordered regions of the proteins actually interact with RNA. So basically, we can enrich for the cross-linked peptides that come from these sorts of analysis and then sequence them and find out where they were. And then we controlled our analysis using fluorescence anisotropy on synthesized peptides to see whether or not they really did interact with RNA as we predicted. And we came to the conclusion that, well, actually, maybe those disordered regions are kind of important in assembly, and this is a completely fictional movie of what we think might happen if it's going to play. There we go. So we've got a whole protomer coming off the ribosome. In fact, we have a whole polyprotein coming off the ribosome. And the only thing of this which is really going to be available is the N-terminus of... That was a fast movie. I had to speak faster. I have to run it again. Okay. Let's try again. Right. God, doesn't want to play. Never mind. So we have the polyprotein coming off the ribosome. The only free disordered region is the first N-terminus. That has a high propensity to interact with RNA, but it doesn't interact with the RNA in the virion. In the virion, it's a structural part of the virion. It's important for bringing proteins together. And so we think that it's feeling the RNA in the cell and saying, yes, I'd like to have some of you come along. And as it interacts with the RNA, we get the cleavage of the capsid proteins going on. They stay together because they come as polyprotein. And so if they're folding as they come off the ribosome, they will actually have already the interactions which are required to keep them together. And then if you've got a fleeting interaction with the RNA, then probably that keeps these together as you're trying to make an assembly. And then as the protomers from different proteins come together, interact laterally to make, for instance, a pentamer where you have a pocket, then the RNA can be dragged into that pocket because of the fact you've had these intrinsically disordered regions. They're already making interactions with the RNA. Perhaps. That's my theory, at least. There has to be an initial step of interaction rather than just a specific interaction that drives the whole assembly. Right. So, obviously, realizing that there's a lot of biology linked to the RNA, not just in coding proteins. So we've also been exploring RNA release in coronaviruses. Now, what you need to know is that expansion is a really common step in coronavirus RNA release in vitro, and commonly it's been studied by heating up the capsids to a physiologically relevant 55 degrees C, or then by low pH treatment, because many of these viruses need low pH in order to get through the endosome. However, Echovirus 1, Coxsackievirus A9, and B3, these enter through the endosome, and yet they're not actually activated by low pH. And they take quite a long time to get through the endosome. And our collaborators in Uvascular, Varko Marjamäki and her PhD student, found that it was possible to isolate an infectious particle, which was kind of expanded, porous, still had the RNA inside it, at 37 degrees C, actually under physiological conditions. So we had a look at this, and you can see already in negative stain and also by cryo that if this is the control particle, then those that have been treated, they already look different just in the micrographs. They look a little bit rougher, and there is a 4% increase in the size. And they certainly still have RNA inside. And you can see that also from 2D averages of the control particles, empty particles, and then these treated particles look like they don't have so much RNA inside, but that's because it's expanded and the particle is porous. So what they did in Varko's lab was to use a real-time fluorescence RNA accessibility measurement to basically probe lots of different conditions that would cause the opening up of these particles. It's a very simple assay. Basically, you've got cyber green in the tube where you're looking in your plate reader, actually. And when the RNA is accessible to the dye, then you start to see an increase in the fluorescence. And so, for instance, if we look at this red complete line here, so in a particular condition of sodium, potassium, and a low amount of calcium, you see the increase in fluorescence with time as you incubate it in, incubate the capsids in this buffer. And then you want to know, well, is the RNA actually released, or is it just in a porous particle with the RNA inside? And so what you do is, at the same time, you have a parallel experiment, which is shown down here. And there you've added RNAs to the well, and therefore, if the RNA comes out, it gets digested, and then you don't see any fluorescence. And so by doing hundreds of these sorts of assays, he worked out these conditions where you can cause this sort of priming of the particle, but not release the RNA. That one might run. Will that one run? Possibly. Yeah, and so basically what you see with all of these coronaviruses that undergo such a small expansion is that you get a rotation and a gentle expansion occurring between protomers. And this is just one such example where you can see some holes appearing around the two folds and around the three folds. Now, what was interesting with this study was that all he needed to do was he had to have it at 37 degrees C, and he just changed the ion conditions to be those which you find within the endosome. Sounds good. The other thing that you can do is add serum albumin to the experiment, and if you do that, serum albumin actually normally is not saturated with fatty acids. It carries a lot of fatty acids, but it's not saturated with them. And these virus particles very often have, within the VP1, they have usually a palmitate moiety, so basically a fatty acid type moiety inside here. And when you add the serum albumin to the virus, then serum albumin has higher affinity for the fatty acid than the virus, and so it comes out, and that also causes expansion. And this is just a schematic to show you the difference between the control particle and the treated particle. So you can see, yes, we can see the RNA on the inside. In both of these, we can see how not only the protein, but also the RNA moves with this expansion. And so as it moves, you also will see that it's less heavily packaged. And the expansion, even though it's only 4%, causes the squashing of this pocket in VP1, and the we see the fatty acid moiety has been removed. Now, I said when we were talking about parechovirus that, you know, there's a lot of the structure that we don't reveal. This is also the case here as well. When you do a difference imaging to say, okay, well, what is it that I haven't modeled at atomic resolution, which is very important to do, then obviously you see the RNA is not modeled in this case, but also we have regions on the outside of the capsid where we've got some unmodeled region, and this is, again, one of the capsid protein termini, which normally hangs on the inside, is now coming to the outside, and it does that because in order to penetrate the endosome, it actually needs to make little channels in the endosome, and these are the proteins that are responsible for doing that. So whenever you make a model, make sure you look at the stuff that you don't model. All right. Okay, so I said that we can activate these particles. You have these changes in RNA distribution. You have changes in these lipid factors. Interestingly, this doesn't require a receptor, but also the change that we see doesn't interfere with the receptor binding site. And so this could happen, for instance, in your blood, where you have serum albumin. Virus is moving around your blood. You could be activating all these particles ready to infect you better. Alternatively, the activation could also happen within the endosome, either by this change in ion conditions or by the fact that the endosome is a membrane-bound compartment. And so the membrane will also have a higher affinity for the lipid in the capsid than the capsid itself. Right. So, thinking again about antivirals, so one of the things that we've been doing is to look at neutralizing monoclonal antibodies. And this is a neutralizing monoclonal antibody produced actually by AIM Therapeutics in Amsterdam. And I put this one in A because it's a really nice structure from data collected in OPIC by Ashra. But interestingly, it's hitting an interface between two protomers. And what I said was that this expansion is important for the release of the RNA. We thought that, I mean, it's certainly true that this antibody is neutralizing partly because it blocks receptor binding. So we see that these don't bind very well to the cells. But also, it's blocking probably this expansion as well, and so probably has a dual effect in terms of neutralizing. And I put that in because our final sort of new antiviral area that we've been interested in is really the idea of stabilizing these capsids with small molecules rather than stabilizing them with monoclonal antibodies. Monoclonal antibodies, you need to make one for every virus variation that you have, and that's not going to be very commercially worthwhile. And so we teamed up with the Nuts Lab in Leuven, and they've been doing a lot of screening of many, many different small molecules to see which ones inhibit viruses. And they came up with this one, which is affectionately called compound 17, and found that it inhibited the growth of Coxsackie virus B3, so-called Nancy strain. Why is Nancy important? Because I told you that these coronaviruses normally have this pocket where you have a lipid bound, and this molecule can be replaced by small drug molecules. There's been a lot of work done on this. It was actually a target which was identified by Michael Rossman in some of the very, very early coronavirus structures back in the 80s. But the only one that ever went to market was then taken off the market, and there's still work being done on trying to find something that binds here, which would be usable in patients. Nancy strain has a mutation, single amino acid mutation, in the one of the amino acids which lines this pocket in VP1, and it never binds a lipid here. And so if you're looking for a compound that binds somewhere else on the capsid, this is a good strain to use, and so this is the one which the Newts lab had used. Right, and so these are some real data to show you how effectively this compound 17 works. So here we have an increasing concentration of the compound, and here we have the inhibition of virus production as measured by plaques. And you can see here in the dotted line with the circles, this is Coxsackie virus B3, and you can see that this is the virus which is most readily affected by this compound, so it's working at 0.1 micromolar concentration. And so this is a plaque assay. You can get a little bit more information about how it works if you look at the viral RNA load. And so again, if you have increasing amounts of the compound, you have here the viral RNA count, and you see that the amount is decreasing. This is an indication that this inhibitor is working on the virus at an early stage of infection, but it's not proof. We had an idea that probably the compound was binding to the capsid. So this is a structure of the virus at 2.8 angstrom resolution. These are now data collected in Diamond. And as you can obviously see, those of you who have a trained eye, the pink circle shows you where the drug is bound. It's very nice when the reconstructions come with a pink circle. So obviously, in order to locate the drug within this structure, it was important to be able to actually model this to atomic resolution, and this was possible. This is just pulling out a few of the proteins from the structure, and then this is a close-up showing you the density for the drug within the viral capsid. Okay, so I was absolutely amazed when we saw this. Even the first structure we made was around 4 angstroms, and we could immediately see the drug. I was really, really surprised. It was one of those very nice moments. Okay, and this is now a refined structure where we can see very clearly the orientation of the drug. We also didn't know the chemical composition of the drug, because Johan didn't tell us. So we said, it's like this, and it's about this big. And then they told us the structure of the drug. And so it was very nice that they also matched. Okay. And so obviously at this resolution now, we can look at this pocket and we can see which are the conserved residues, which are the ones which are interacting with the drug, and we can make predictions of which ones might be important. And what they did in Newts lab was also to test some of our predictions to see whether or not, if we made mutations in these amino acids, they would confer resistance against the drug. And some of these indeed did confer resistance, but in each case they also dropped the viability of the virus quite dramatically. All right, so, and in some of the cases, actually these amino acids are essential and they can't be mutated, which is also a very good sign for a pocket that you want to try to target. And in terms of the energy of the interaction, these are actually, for this particular compound, this is actually quite low. For instance, I have it on here, on this slide here, there's a new lipid pocket binding factor which has come from the Stewart lab, and they said that this is the best compound they've found so far, and that has an energy of minus 66 kilocals per mole, and our calculation for this one is even better, minus 73. So this looks really quite promising. So where does it bind? So this is where the fatty acid binds within a prodomer of Coxsackie virus B3. So that binds within this VP1 protein coloured in blue. But what happens with the compound 17 is that it actually sits between protomers. And so that's why you had to hear all the rest of this introduction, was because now you know that this protomer-protomer interaction is really critical, not only for RNA release, but also for the assembly of these viruses. And so I think it's quite an interesting new area to explore for drug targeting. And so this is now a very new structure of Coxsackie virus B4, which Justin has just finished, and he's just finished building the atomic model for this. And again, now we have a different drug in here, which was binding preferentially to this virus, which is also readily visible within the reconstruction. And again, in here, it's sitting in exactly the same position, which is good. You can see again the density here within the overall density. You can see, well, not terribly well in this representation, but in terms of the complementarity of the hydrophobic interactions, it makes a lot of sense. And so we have a second drug which binds in the same pocket. I think this is really interesting. In fact, what Ben did was to look at 62 different drug analogues, varying the positions of on the drug, to then see if we could get a broader range inhibitor from such screening, and then also to screen 12 different enterovirus and rhinovirus strains to see if we could pick up different compounds that would work well with these different picornaviruses. So this is a heat map, and it's a heat map where black means nada, didn't have any effect on the virus. Funny gray stipulated stuff didn't do the experiment. Pale blue means that we had a hit, which looks really interesting. And so actually we have a number of different compounds now that we're following up. And with these newer reconstructions where we can actually really look at the interactions in the pockets, I think we have a very good chance of developing some more interesting small molecule inhibitors. And with that, I'm going to finish and thank some of the great people in my lab which do all the work, and let me come swanning to Nissan instead. So I especially want to thank two previous postdocs in the lab. So Shabby did a huge amount of work on precoviruses now in the LMB, and James was very instrumental in the Coxsackie virus B3 study with the drug. And more recently, Aushra and Justin have been working on the picornavirus work. This is Benita and Passi, who are doing most of the microscopy in Helsinki. This is Marta Caroni, who joined us in Portugal in September for an EU kickoff meeting. She collected the CVB4 data in Sweden, in SciLife Lab. Varpo and Visa did the work on the RNA release. And obviously all the people in Johan's lab who contributed to this very interesting study with the antiviral compounds in the new pocket. Lots and lots of funding agencies. And I very rarely have a second analysis slide, but as I covered now work going back over about 6 years, I realized there were lots of important people. So especially in Leiden, so Bram actually allowed us access to Nissen. Well, this one structure of precovirus. Leeds and York, so Raynon and Peter's lab for, again, the work with the Celex and working out packaging signals. Tim O'Hoopia for getting me into picornaviruses a long time ago, and Petri Susie, who does a lot of work with us on picornaviruses. Oh, look, I put them there twice, they're so important. SciTech, so again, one of the data sets was collected in SciTech. Tim for the development of monoclonal antibodies. Katja for working with us on a lot of precovirus work. And then Gao and Vaughan, whose were very viable for the RCAP studies. And you for your attention. Thank you.